Hi everyone, welcome. I'm so glad that you could join us for this February Park Bench Chat. I'm Diane Regas. I'm the CEO and president of the Trust for Public Land. We've been hosting these events for 2 years now and since the onset of the pandemic, and it's hard to believe it's been just about 2 years. We've really enjoyed it, and I very much appreciate all of you who've continued to tune in and be part of these vitally important conversations about nature, health, community, and equity. So Sony Pictures Entertainment is sponsoring today's Park Bench Chat, and we have the Sony family tuning in. So I just want to say a special welcome to all of you. Sony Pictures is an important partner accelerating the preservation of Black historical and cultural sites nationwide. And Keith Weaver, who's the Executive Vice President overseeing global policy and external affairs at Sony Pictures Entertainment, is on our board here at TPL, and he chairs our Black History and Culture Advisory Council. We're so grateful for this partnership with Sony. In a moment, four incredible leaders who've long championed equity, equality, and recognition of America's full story will be joining us. Before we start that conversation, I want to share just a little bit about the Trust for Public Land for those of you who are joining us for the first time. For almost 50 years, we at TPL have worked to connect everyone to the benefits and joys of the outdoors. As a national nonprofit, our fundamental mission is to work directly with communities around the country to create outdoor places where they are needed the most. Whether you live in a dense city or a remote rural area, access to the outdoors is essential to well-being, to public health, to climate resiliency, and to community identity. But we know that access to parks and public lands is not equitable. Decades of neglect and injustice have left too many communities behind, without the quality places they need to get outside. TPL is leading a movement to close this outdoor equity gap once and for all by creating joyful places, transforming asphalt into grass and trees, connecting communities with trails, and preserving those spaces that reflect the history and culture of America's many ethnicities and cultures. Since 1972, we've protected more than 3 million acres of public land. We've created more than 5,000 parks, trails, green schoolyards, and iconic outdoor places. We've raised $84 billion in public funding for parks and public land, and we've connected more than 9 million people to the outdoors. But to close the outdoor equity gap, we have many more acres, dollars, laws, and hearts to protect, to connect, to raise, to change, and to inspire. So I'm welcoming all of you today, especially those of you who are joining us for the first time, and I invite you to join this movement to connect everyone to the benefits and the joys of the outdoors. Now, let's get this Park Bench Chat started, and I'm going to turn it over to Malcolm Carson. Malcolm?
Thank you, Diane, for those inspiring words about our work and our mission. Hi, everyone. I'm Malcolm Carson. I'm Senior Vice President and General Counsel for the Trust for Public Land. I've been a leader of the core team that's been heading up our Black History and Culture area of work. I'm thrilled to be joining you today for this Park Bench Chat about preserving lands and spaces that hold our history. We have an incredible group of panelists today who I'll introduce in just a moment. But first, let's just for a moment consider that only 2% of sites listed in the National Register of Historic Places represent the experience of African Americans. This underrepresentation deprives us of a full understanding of the story of America, and going forward presents the grave risk that many important places will be lost to development or neglect. TPL is committed to correcting this failure. For decades, we've worked with communities and important partners like Sony, as just mentioned, and welcome to all the people from Sony, the 1772 Foundation, National Park Service, and many others too numerous to mention, to preserve such valuable places. These often overlooked historical and cultural sites hold unrealized potential to enrich all of our communities and provide Americans with a deeper understanding of our nation. And today there is increasingly broad awareness that accelerating their preservation is vitally important. Joining us are three inspiring leaders championing efforts to ensure the full story of America is preserved and shared. First with me today is Angela Bates, the Executive Director of the Nicodemus Historical Society. Nicodemus, founded in 1877, is the oldest and only remaining African-American settlement west of the Mississippi River, and Angela is a descendant of the first settlers. Angela has devoted much of her career to preserving and sharing the history and architecture in Nicodemus and led the successful effort to get Nicodemus designated a National Historic Site. Welcome, Angela. It's such an honor to have you join us.
Thank you. I am very pleased to be able to have this opportunity yet again to tell and share the story of this dynamic history here at Nicodemus. It's just a pleasure to be invited.
Angela, open your camera. We want to see you. There you go. Okay. We also have Naomi Davis joining us. Naomi is the founder and president of Blacks in Green, as well as an urban theorist, attorney, activist, and proud granddaughter of Mississippi shareholders. Davis serves as a bridge and catalyst among communities and their stakeholders in the design and development of green, self-sustaining, mixed-income, walkable villages in communities owned and populated by African-Americans. The organization recently stepped in to save Emmett Till's childhood home in Chicago from demolition and is planning a museum on the site, which will be the focal point of a future walkable village. Hi, Naomi. So welcome.
Thank you for having me. I know that was more than a mouthful, but it's a joy.
It's not even enough. Thank you. Our final panelist is Dr. Faborn Carson, who is a Stanford professor emeritus and the nation's foremost scholar on the life and works of Martin Luther King Jr. We at the Trust for Public Land are fortunate to have Dr. Carson as a member of our Black History and Culture Advisory Council. And I'm fortunate enough to call Dr. Carson Dad. Dr. Carson is here to talk about the Meadowood Project in Connecticut. Dr. Carson, thank you for joining us today. You're muted.
Thank you for having me. I'm glad to be here with you, and good to have an opportunity to see you other than on weekends.
Yeah. All right, so let's get started. We'll spend the first 30 minutes or so hearing about these amazing projects and the important stories and the lessons they impart. And we'll then open it up for questions towards the end. So we're gonna start with Angela. Nicodemus is an effort that we in TPL have been aware of and supporting for more than two decades. Talk to us about the story of this incredible place and how you and the other descendants have worked to keep it and the dreams of the original settlers alive.
Well, Nicodemus is a unit of the National Park Service now and has been since 1996. It represents what African Americans experienced in the West by migrating out of this war-torn and Jim Crow South into the promised lands of Kansas, where they could experience real freedom and become homesteaders or landowners and participate in the manifest destiny as the government was trying to achieve during this time period. Nicodemus was established in 1877 by former slaves from primarily central bluegrass Kentucky. Georgetown and Lexington is the major areas that they came from. There were subsequent groups that did come from Tennessee as well as Mississippi, but the bulk of the people that came and the ones that remained over the years were the descendants of those that came from the Kentucky area. They came primarily because the push out of the South was Jim Crow and all of the violence that they were experiencing. And the draw was the land, it was homesteading. And the catalyst for them to come was a group of ministers and a white man who was a town regulator or a town builder. And so they organized the Nicodemus Town Company, located the land on 161 acres, just on the north side of the Solomon River in the promised lands of Kansas. They went to back home to Kentucky, and they went to the churches, and primarily because of the Jim Crow laws, African-Americans could not gather together in large groups except for at church. So they went to the churches and they promoted the town. And September of 1877, they brought a group, the very first major group out of Kentucky. They arrived in about September of 1877. And then the next group that actually came that spring of 1878. And a couple of smaller groups came. And then the last large group that came from the Leavenworth area of Kansas. But most of those people were former slaves in Georgetown and the Lexington area. So they came, they survived that first year because of the Native Americans, the Osage, and the Potawatomis who were in the area, traversing through the area, coming back from getting government supplies and hunts, shared their game with the people of Nicodemus that first year. So that's how they survived. Over the years, they continued to grow. And then about the mid-80s, they were attracting the railroads that were laying track through the area. And Nicodemus never got the railroad. It went south of the town about 4 miles purposely. And the little town of Bogue came into existence. Once that happened, the economic viability of Nicodemus began to decline. And people, there were a few white merchants that disassembled their building like the banker did. The Bank of Nicodemus was operated by a white man by the name of McPherson. They moved their businesses over to the town of Bogue, and that pulled out the economic viability and sustainability of Nicodemus as a growing community. And then going into the Great Depression and the Dust Bowl years of the 1930s, Nicodemus began to continue to decline. And so presently, we have about 22 people that actually live on the town site. What keeps Nicodemus surviving even to this day is not only our spirit of determination, but the idea that every year we have celebrated the Emancipation Celebration. That becomes the catalyst for people to come back and reconnect not only with the town and this place called Nicodemus, but home and all of the families. And so this year we'll be celebrating our 144th Emancipation Celebration. It's always the last weekend in July. In 1996, when we became a unit of the National Park Service, five historic buildings were designated as a part of that designation. And so we started the Historical Society and we spearheaded those efforts to get it designated. And so we work hard to continue to collect our history, preserve it, and interpret it here at Nicodemus.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you so much, Angela. That's an amazing story, and congratulations for all of your work and making that happen.
Thank you.
I know it was a long effort. So I want to bring Naomi in. So Blacks in Green recently stepped in to save this Emmett Till home in Chicago from demolition. It's now slated to be this museum, walkable village, center of the community, center of history and culture. Can you tell us a little bit more about this?
Well, it's my honor. I am a proud granddaughter of Mississippi sharecroppers, as I like to say. I come from white gloves and mud. And as it turns out, destiny handed me this card. I was born the day before Emmett was slain, and my family was born and raised 13 miles as the crow flies from Money, Mississippi, where the murder occurred. And all of my life, I was raised in an Afrocentric home. I was taught to love our people. I too was one of those millions of children who were sent south for the summer. And so it is a personal relationship that I have. And when I moved to our walkable village of West Woodlawn back in 2010, I was astounded to discover that this precious asset of the Till family home was in disgraced condition, I'll just say, and that people weren't aware of it, and people were not responding to the early tours that I set up on foot with students. And so the idea that we took the inspiration of the ancestors, that great migration group that moved up south for freedom and economic opportunity, and that we began to institutionalize that, until today we have really a pretty rousing, really activated a group of neighbors and a city. We just did a press conference, the Coalition of Black House Museums, where we each presented our house museum to, we had, you know, five different stations there, and everybody from across the city was a sigh on the news because they really care. When we first announced that we purchased this building, we got 25,000 communications from all over the world. Wow. That this was an asset that, you know, that others valued also. So our personal inspiration has really snowballed into a really revived inspiration. And the Department of Planning and Development has given us funds to restore the exterior, and is looking at how to expand development in the region of the Tillhouse to really amplify tourism. So we are definitely going to be stewarding a tourism economy in West Woodlawn. We have the big heritage tour company that's launching on Juneteenth. And we are able to continue the regular programming that brings in the community to do the history, such as the Trial in the Delta, which is coming up right now, a collaboration with Collaboration Theater that takes the actual transcript of the Emmett Till trial that's been lost for decades and dramatizes it. So we'll be having a conversation about that tomorrow night. And it's the youth. It's getting our youth who've been walking up and down these streets for decades past this blighted property. We actually had squatters in the building when we bought it. And so the idea that we are carefully cultivating it, we have a pre-curator we've hired to begin to organize curators from around the world. I want to hear from people in the audience today. Are you Till enthusiasts? Do you have special curatorial knowledge or a family story? We want to see and hear from you about how you think we should be advancing this rare American asset.
Thank you. It's greatly appreciated. So I'm going to bring Dr. Carson in now. So one of the Trustburg Public Lands' most notable projects has been the Martin Luther King National Historical Park near downtown Atlanta. But there's another, so far much lesser known site we've just recently protected that also has an MLK connection. And that, of course, is Meadowood, a tobacco farm in Connecticut where he worked during the summers while a student at Morehouse. And we're wondering if you could talk to us about the impact that King's time there had in shaping his path, and so now so many others that also were there from Black colleges, and how that influenced the civil rights movement and in turn the course of American history.
Well, I think that you can see from this quote from Martin Luther King himself that this time he spent at Simsbury and at this tobacco farm and in Hartford were great impact on his life. Because for the first time, he could stay for an extended time outside the South and see that the segregation rules that that he had grown up around, he could get away from them for a while. And even something as simple as going to a restaurant and being able to sit wherever he wanted, to be able to go to a church that was predominantly white, to be able to have a conversation with white teenagers his own age. All of these were experiences that were new to him and not only impactful in terms of what he gained from that, but you can imagine when he's coming back on the train and he reaches Washington, D.C., and he has to switch to a Jim Crow car. So that visible indication that, yes, I got away for a summer like these other students, but once I get back, it's the same as before. Another thing that should be said about this is that he makes his decision to become a minister here. When he goes away at the age of 15, he entered Morehouse early. He thought about being a lawyer and I think was leaning in that direction, despite the implicit pressure from his father, the fact that his father and grandfather had been ministers. But he wanted to go into the law. But he finds out when he's there that the other Morehouse students look to him for leadership. They want him to lead their religious sessions, and he's good at it. And it's something that he's grown up around. So it's in 1948, after returning from Simsbury, that he tells his mother first and then his father that he has made a decision to become an ordained minister. And his father is so pleased by this decision that he arranges to have him ordained within months. He's ordained as an 18-year-old. Now, I guess he was 19 when he got back. But in any case, he's very quickly ordained as a minister. And so in some ways, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King that we know really was a creation of his time that he spent in Simsbury. But that was the inspiration, that he saw the possibilities for change. He made his largest decision about how he was going to spend his career. And this was true for one student, but when you multiply it by hundreds of other Morehouse students who had the same kind of or similar kind of experience, I think you can see why this warrants being a historic site.
Thank you. I'm going to bring it back to Angela now. So many of these sites we know are at risk of being lost or forgotten altogether. Given all that you've accomplished to preserve the story of Nicodemus, which could have been lost in a similar way if people like you hadn't stepped up and done what you did, what advice could you impart to others who may be looking to make sure that important Black historic sites in their own communities are not lost or forgotten?
Well, for me in particular, because I'm a descendant of those first settlers that arrived here in 1877, it was in my blood. I was passionate about the history. I was, even though I grew up in Pasadena, California, every summer we would come home to Nicodemus for the Emancipation Celebration, and we'd spend a couple of weeks there. So I was indoctrinated purely just by being there every summer to think that this place needed to be preserved. I was a descendant of Black pioneers, of cowboys and Buffalo soldiers. And my mother cooked for a family that knew John Wayne, and John Wayne would come to their house for dinner. It was John Wayne's best friend. And my mother would come home and she would say, the Duke was there. And he told my mother that he enjoyed her cooking and her apple pie and fried chicken, but he wasn't that fond of Black people. And my mother had made a comment to him about, she could have been as prejudiced as him. But we were still proud of the fact that even though we were not seen on television, that we had our own all Black town. And I knew it was important for us to preserve that history. So when I became an adult, and I continued to come home, as I was seeing the town start to deteriorate, especially the five historic buildings that were key to the iconic downtown Main Street area of this little Western town, it was important to me that, and very selfishly, I thought it was important for us to preserve that history. So national site designation was something that had been suggested to me by Ira Hutchison, who had been a part of the historic Black colleges and for the National Park Service. So with his prompting and my cousin, Verl Schweitzer, who is a NFL football player who integrated the Green Bay Packers. With their encouragement, I took the baton and I just went forward, and it never occurred to me that it shouldn't happen. And I always thought that since the National Park Service could spend millions of dollars on dead presidents' houses and places that were significant to them, it was just as important that our chapter in American history be preserved through the national site designation. So I say, find the places that tells the stories, and you know, use your passion and your wherewithal and your dedication to preserving this history to make sure that those lives that went before us, that we're standing on their foundation, we are standing on the foundation of them, and their stories not be lost. Let that be the motivation to drive us to remember and not forget, and to make sure that the nation doesn't forget, because we're a part of this story. We're not an afterthought. We should have been at the forefront all along, but what better time than now?
Thank you. I mean, I could see that passion is definitely the fuel that that made sure that this was going to happen, no matter what kind of obstacles were placed in the path. I want to go to Naomi now. I want to talk a little bit about you know, a lot of Black history and culture sites are located adjacent to African American communities that are facing familiar sets of challenges that go on in distressed communities around social, economic, environmental challenges, such as the case with the Emmett Till House. It's in a neighborhood of Chicago that's facing its own set of challenges. And I think we're really curious about, you know, how historic preservation of these kinds of sites can spark community revitalization in these kinds of communities more broadly.
You're hitting on one of my very most favorite topics. I alluded just briefly earlier that I was, you know, as soon as I realized there was a Till House in my neighborhood, I started, you know, I alerted the media and I started doing tours and with the students, and there's this thing called Jane's Walk that happens relative to Jane Jacobs that I early on began to tie into that citywide programming. But more than that, when we talk about our sustainable square mile, and that's that place where you can walk to work, walk to shop, walk to learn, walk to play, where African-Americans own the businesses, they own the land, we live the conservation lifestyle, we are definitely in the business as Blacks and Green in creating economies. And that means not just the workforce, but also the enterprise owners, also the customers. And so that three-legged stool of customers, workers, and business owners, we have been busy beating the bushes for a lot of years now to say, look, you can be in the tourism business. Anyone can make a t-shirt and a mug. Okay, we're just a few blocks down the road from the Obama Presidential Center, just a few blocks down the road from the DuSable Museum of African American History. And here we are, like this triumvirate where the lowly, you know, sort of classic Chicago two flat, you know, beautiful in our eyes, but not necessarily architecturally gorgeous or fancy, but so magnetic. So we have been ramping up the business of encouraging people to be in the tourism business. And so we are providing workshops, and we are hopefully going to be also able to give some small funding to small, might be a household, might be a mom and a pop, might be a young person in high school. We want to get everyone recognizing that tourism is a $1 trillion industry. It's one of the top industries in the city of Chicago. We are in Bronzeville, USA, in the Obama Presidential District, the Black Metropolis National Heritage Area. And we are at the tip of the Black Belt. And the Black Belt was that great migration stronghold that created our walkable village of West Woodlawn. Well, we were not allowed to live to the east, not allowed to live to the west, not allowed to live to the south. And we crowded into this beautiful little trapezoid called West Woodlawn, historic West Woodlawn. And we have many, many luminaries from the 1900s who have lived there. And so what we're saying to neighbors is, whatever your idea may be about business, we've got your back. We want to support you. We have a map that we are developing. I think I mentioned that we are launching our own tourism business per se on Juneteenth of this year. So we'll have a great festivity at the Till House. That's the Emmett and Mamie Till Mobley House Museum, Garden and Theater. We know it's a long name, but we want to make sure everybody knows there's something in there for everybody. We have a horticultural cohort. We can hire people to help care for the land of that Till campus. We've bought two adjoining lots to put the garden space in. We've got internationally renowned sculptor Richard Hunt, who has committed to a commission of a large sculpture for the front lawn that'll be bringing visitors by. We want to say to our neighbors, look, we're going to have some fish in this barrel. What have you got to sell them? We also, when we say garden and theater, we're putting in a small performance space on the two lots next door. So we'll have garden space and theater space. Why? Because intergenerational learning, telling our own story in our own words, especially the elders and the youth doing that intergenerational relationship building. We are expecting to advance a genre called community performance for economic development, which was taught to us by the founders of that genre, Richard Gere from Community Performance International, and Kevin Ayega Jeff of Deeply Rooted. And we're gonna be putting on musicals, and we're gonna be having on the regular shows, and we're going to, I remember being a kid in the theater.
It's gonna be a center of life and prosperity and
yes.
for that community. So thank you, that's super exciting.
Thank you.
So last question to Dr. Carson. So as a historian, can you talk to us a little bit about how preserving and activating these kinds of spaces helps to tell a more complete story? You know, sort of what role can physical markers and landscapes of significance to Black history and culture play in helping us better understand our collective story?
I think that anyone who's been to Washington and walked around the memorials there, been to the King Memorial, which I helped design, been to the Lincoln Memorial, and you understand all the important events that happened there. To me, historical tourism is something that I think is underappreciated economically, even though it does have an impact, as has been pointed out, on the communities where tourists go. But it also has an impact more generally on our understanding of history. You know, when you're the statistic that you quoted right at the beginning about what is it, just a couple of percent of all the historical, you know, when you,
2%,
when you
think of
that, how many times do you take your family, your kids to historical sites? And the fact that so few of them represent African-American history, even though, to me, the Lincoln Memorial is partly famous for Abraham Lincoln, but partly famous because King gave his great speech there and because of the great demonstration in 1963. So in some ways, we can claim sites that maybe were not originally developed for that purpose and make them into teaching lessons in African-American history. And that's been my joy as a teacher. As you know, I've taken my students on a tour of King's life, starting at his birth home, ending in Memphis, and going through all the places where he spent significant time. And I can see that it has an impact on them because history becomes alive. I'd love to do that on the virtually too. And I think that that's another possibility. Simsbury has not been on my tours. It would add considerably to the cost to go up north and see that. But I can imagine that King in the north, he spent time at Crozier Theological Seminary in Pennsylvania, spent time at Boston University. And those were significant periods of his life. And so you can learn a lot about him from going to these sites. And I can envision the day that if not, it might have to be virtually just because they're not all connected together. But if I wanted to teach a course about Martin Luther King, and I do that all the time, that's what I do. I want to bring them to the spot. I want them to know what 16th Street Church in Birmingham looks like. I want them to know what his birth home looked like, what it meant to grow up in the Auburn Avenue area of Atlanta. And if we can possibly get up to Connecticut, you know, the tremendous impact that experience had on his life. And I think that that's going to be part of my teaching in any case, because now we're getting a lot of footage of the place. We'd like to do virtual realities of them, and I suspect some of the other people here have thought about that idea, maybe for the Emmett Till home, to do a virtual reality so that you can show what it was like to live in a place like that. And also that allows you to connect it to other historic sites. I spent my career making documentaries, more than 24 of them, and they're all based around that idea that if you go back and go to the places where history happened, that can deepen the insight that people have. You know, just like every year people go to Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma to commemorate the Voting Rights March that started there. And I can easily see this happening with hundreds of other sites around the nation.
Right, thank you. I can remember when first time you took our family down to the MLK site, that definitely had a huge impact on me, not having experienced directly what everything in these books were talking about. So we're gonna go to Q&A now. Thank you to the panelists, and we'll get some more from the panelists, but let's start with Peter Stein. A great question in my view, which is like, how are we gonna do more of this work and who else do we need to partner with? That's a really great lead in to, you could contribute to helping to, we're gonna have links in the, coming to you if you register to this, we're gonna have a link. We're gonna pop up a link in the chat as well. We have a fund that we're collecting contributions from everybody, no dollars too small, and we're actually having an anonymous donor has stepped up to triple the contribution that you give. And so just during Black History Month. So this is a great time to help us expand this work. We actually have several dozen sites in various stages of development that we've worked on, and we're partnering with community at every one of these sites. And some of the funds that we use to sort of support those partners in their work. So you know that contribution will sort of spread far and wide. So I would highly encourage that. Maybe I can throw it out to the panelists. Are there ideas on how this body of work in general at TPL and elsewhere can be expanded to begin to more closely approximate the need?
One thing I would mention is mapping. Right now we are developing a historical map for affiliate organizations to the one that I direct. And it's, I found how simple it is it's really just getting the work of putting a Google map together that then could be disseminated through an app that you could put on your phone, so that wherever you go in the country, you would know whether you're near a Black historic site. And I would imagine that would make traveling across the country so much more interesting to people, because sometimes you could be driving through it and not recognize that there's a historic site near you. It would be so wonderful for teaching kids that Black people have been everywhere in this country. And that needs to be recognized.
Yeah, it's great that you say that, because we Brent Legs is one of the members on our advisory council, and he's also executive director of the African American Cultural Heritage Action Fund at the National Trust for Historic Preservation. And he's reached out to us. TPO has some great data and mapping capacities. And so we're developing, hopefully, some kind of a partnership with them to do exactly that, to map all these sites all across the country and make it available, so that when you're traveling around, you'll be able to know exactly what's there. And not only that, to sort of unearth these sites so that we can bring the proper focus on them, that they'll be preserved.
In the state of Kansas, back in the early 90s, I did a Kansas African American history tour, and wrote an article, and then we, with the Kansas Tourism, we turned it into a map. And then here in the last several years, the African American Museum in Wichita got a funding to really take that and really expand it. And now, it is utilized throughout the state and promoted throughout the state as a Kansas African American history trail. And there's sites all over the state that relate not only to places like Nicodemus, but to the military forts where the Buffalo Soldiers were, to Underground Railroad sites and what have you. So it would be great if each state could identify their African American heritage sites and create a map on a state level, and it would be easier to collaborate all of that on a national level.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Thank you. So I have another question coming in, which is, does the group have a, collective favorite? Is there a threatened site that you know about that needs priority attention?
I'm going to be a little biased here. A lot of African American place in the South and the East. And I remember when I was living in the DC area, I went to a Smithsonian exhibit on the migration to the North. And I said, really the first migration of the African American out of the South was through the West. And so it's just been in, I think, recent years, and I say the last 25 years or so, that we have learned about the African American experience in the West, Black cowboys, Buffalo Soldiers, and what have you. And now with Nicodemus as a National Historic Site, we're beginning to understand that there was a role that was being played in the settling of the West. And so I would love to see a lot more of sites be uncovered and designated, and the history of them being brought to life. And it really kind of speaks to the country after slavery. And after Reconstruction, what African Americans did here in the West that was which I think was phenomenal. I mean, they created their own all Black towns and became a very important fabric in the settling of the West. So I just would love to see a lot more being brought to light about the history of the African Americans in the West.
Thank you. No, I think you're muted.
I would also chime in to say, I'm going to drop in the chat a video of our Black House Museum press conference on February 10th. And you'll see Muddy Waters, Phyllis Wheatley, A. Philip Randolph, the Pullman Porter Museum, as well as the Honorable Elijah Muhammad House. We are a sisterhood of five founding members who are actively collaborating. We'll be producing our first annual bicycle tour this summer. And we are looking at other houses in the city of Chicago. Recently, the Lou Palmer Mansion was just purchased for a very grand restoration. And we have the Fred Hampton House on the Chicago's West Side that we're looking to also engage there. If you know, you could turn around and toss a penny and hit almost anywhere you are some really interesting sort of intersectional person's place. And we've got to tell our own stories. It doesn't have to be something grand and game-changing like the Till House. Every place has a story. Every story has its characters. Every characters have a stage, and you find those places and you lift them up, and who knows what kind of creativity and genius the children of the Great Migration can foment here to get some pride, to tell that story in ways that young and old alike are just refreshed and revived and validated. We call it the narrative of triumph. We are people of triumph. And we, everywhere you look, there's evidence of it.
Excellent, thank you. And I'll just, you know, add on, you know, in my position at TPR, I've sort of, you know, been getting a lot of people, you know, calling, and one of the things that I think everybody should, you know, might want to look at in their own communities, not one site, but, you know, there's cemeteries there that Black people established in all over the country. And generally speaking, they're often not protected in any way. And so they can be, you know, torn, you know, bulldozed over, you know, by, you know, and that, and sometimes, you know, that it might be on a scale that's small enough that it's hard to get the attention of, you know, some, you know, a national organization that really come, you know, that kind of national park, you know, it's just a small few acres, and we
get a few good neighbors together, you know.
Yeah, and so it's really you know, trying to figure out, yes, that's a whole thread of things that I think it could be interesting to make sure that we honor those spaces properly. I want to take one from Roberta Cohut, and it's directed towards Dr. Carson, and you know, maybe share a little bit about the your courses and what's going on with the World House Project.
Well, the main thing that's going on is we're teaching about Martin Luther King, which is nothing original, but I think what we're doing is teaching it in a new way, that is bringing audiovisual materials into history. King was fortunate to live in the era of television and radio and press conferences and international coverage. And so part of what I've done over the last, since becoming editor of his papers in 1985, is collect all that stuff. You know, traditionally historians collect documents, you know, written materials and things like that. But from the beginning, we've recognized that you have to also go after photographs, audiovisual materials. There's nothing like, King was one of the most interviewed people of his time. There's a wealth of material. Now, obviously, you also have the issue of can you use all this material because somebody owns it? But one thing we found is that in the classroom, I can really make use of a lot of this material, and it brings history alive to students. It impacts them. I call it immersive history, because when they can hear King's voice, hear him being interviewed in his own home, see his interactions with his family, not the famous pictures of him, marching in Washington, but the pictures of him playing with his daughter. These are the celebrating his birthday. These are the things that I think really affect students and make him come alive as a person. And I think that we can do that increasingly with the history books of the future are not going to be a printed text. It's going to be audiovisual.
Yeah.
They won't be books. They will be experiences. And I think the people in this call are part of that process.
Yeah, I mean, setting up these kinds of physical spaces is can be the raw materials for some great, audiovisual, kind of experiences like that. So I think it all fits together. The last question is coming from Martha Wyckoff, which I think several people on the panel, including myself, would probably want to address, which is, what is the way to address gentrification or displacement and the preservation, conservation, and sort of whole community development? And what is TPL's role in that? So similar to in the park space, we have an issue at TPL where we build the most amazing, wonderful, great park. The intention is to serve the people that live there, make their lives better. And we certainly don't want the result of that to be that the people that live there all get moved out because now this is such a wonderful, great neighborhood. And that can happen in the preservation space as well. All of us have probably been places that are sort of have been turned into a museum it's now exclusive to, regular people or the people that might have lived there before the place became such a great tourist attraction. We're working on that within TPL. We consider ourselves to, be involved in coalitions that try to address housing issues, affordability issues, that we try to incorporate the community into the design and development of projects so that people get work, the cultural sort of mores of the community that's there get reflected in what we build and what we do. But it's always going to be a challenge as a place becomes more attractive. There's always that challenge. So I'll throw it out to.
I want to say something about that, which is to say thank you, Trust for Public Land, because there is no substitute in the pushback against a wealth disparity displacement than buying the land. You have got to buy the land, get some neighbors together, put it in an ISUSU. If you want to know more about that, my information is in the chat. But ask your city, ask your county, ask your churches to take up collections. We've got to own. Black communities need to own themselves, and their the exploitation around letting our communities devolve and then buying them back real cheap is a very standard playbook practice. We just have to wake up and put our pennies together. We have enough money if we work together.
Absolutely.
And with friends like TPL.
Yeah, we like buying land. Unless anybody wants to jump in there, I'm gonna wrap this up. I think we've got a few more minutes, but thank you to the panel for joining us today. Thank you to everybody out there in the audience who has joined us. Especially want to thank, obviously Angela, Dr. Carson, Naomi, thank you for joining us and sharing these amazing stories about these amazing places. Also want to thank acknowledge our partners and funders without which this would not be possible. 1772 Foundation stepped up, huge. Sony Pictures Entertainment, we talked about earlier. Members of the Black History and Culture Advisory Council, among too many others, too numerous to mention. Your expert and expertise and partnership has allowed us to save and preserve and activate these important sites across the country. So, you know, just walking in the steps of a young MLK, literally at a farm or sitting in a pew in an African-American church, honoring the struggles and resilience of millions of Blacks who left the South and looking to build a better life, gazing at rafters of a tobacco barn. These are all visceral experiences that we talked about that you can see and touch, and they amplify and expand our connection to this country and to one another. Although much has been tragically lost, thousands of important and meaningful sites remain. So there's a role for all of us to play. Everybody on this call, everybody that's tapped in, everybody that's registered to play in advancing this work. We rely on private support and funders, individuals like you, to protect these important places and allow for a more complete telling of the American story. And as I mentioned earlier, Black History Month, we have your match is 2-to-1. So that means a $100 gift, we match with an extra $200, resulting in 3 times the impact, which is just amazing. We're so grateful and thankful for the leadership of our donor who made that happen. So I'd like to ask each of you to consider making a gift today. We have a dedicated website with that information. I think it's been posted. We'll post it again. And we'll also share an email after this where we'll include more of those kinds of details, and including other details relevant to what we've been talking about.